On behalf of the town of Deerfield, I call this special town meeting to order. I have examined the voter sign-in and determined that a quorum is present. I've also examined the return of the warrant and find it to be in order. There are a relatively few number of articles this evening to get through, so it's my hope that we can move through them efficiently, but give everyone who would like the opportunity to speak that opportunity. I did receive a request from a couple of citizens to ask that when you stand to be recognized, you could also identify your name when you're called upon. Many of us know the faces that are here, but there are some and other members of the town that would appreciate getting to know all of us. So if we could do that, it would be appreciated. Just a brief overview of the rules. As I mentioned, if you wish to speak, please stand and wait to be recognized. There is a microphone at the front of the room. If you wish to address, it really is best if you can come forward and utilize that. As always, motions or amendments that are made from the floor, we'd ask that they be in writing. And again, the voters who will vote this evening should be present on the floor, and those non-voting members are located along the back. So any members in the back that wish to speak would need to do so with the permission of the floor. So there was one singular handout when you walked in, which we referenced throughout the evening. So if you don't have one of those, they're available at the back table as well. So with that said, I would like to move to the first moderator motion. I move that the reading of all articles be waived and that prior to the reading of a motion under the article, the moderator briefly summarize the content of the article to be considered, and further, that unless objection is raised, the reading of detailed motions be waived, where the article as printed can, in the opinion of the moderator, be incorporated by reference in any motion presented. This basically allows us to move through things a bit more efficiently. The articles are printed in the handout, and that will allow us to move right to the motion, which is the action to be taken on the article. Any commentary on that? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The motion carries. I move that the following people be allowed to address the audience during the town meeting: Lisa Mead, Town Council; Brenda Hill, Town Accountant; Douglas Finn, Interim Town Administrator; Sarah Woodbury, Tilton Library Director; Patricia Cavanaugh, Business Manager, Frontier Regional Union 38 Schools; Janine Heil, Principal of Deerfield Elementary School; Daniel Pelota, Project Manager, Professionals, Inc.; Philip O'Brien, Project Planning Professionals, Inc. Is there a second?
Second.
Again, only registered voters are allowed to address the town meeting. This allows individuals who are not residents but who have relevant information to assist in the town meeting's deliberation this evening. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Moving on to the first main article, to rescind prior borrowing authorizations. Selectman Member Camosa?
I move that the town rescind the unused borrowing authority of $232,500 as voted under Article 3 of the special town meeting, August 11th, 2010.
Is there a second to the motion?
Second.
Motion's before the floor, if you'd like to summarize.
Yeah. State law requires a town meeting vote to rescind authorized and unissued debt that is no longer required for its intended purpose.
The Finance Committee wish to comment on it?
No, we had no comment. This is fairly procedural and seemed pretty straightforward.
Any questions from the floor? The 2010 debt was for...
The energy loan, Mark. It was for the energy loan.
Any other comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. The vote is unanimous, and it carries in excess of 2/3. Article 2, the municipal building repairs.
I move the town appropriate $57,687 from municipal building fund for capital projects as specifically set forth in Article 2 of the warrant, a copy of which has been distributed at this meeting, which capital projects and manners are incorporated herein by reference. This will appropriate monies from the municipal building fund in order to fund repairs and upgrade to town buildings in accordance with the town's 5-year capital improvement plan. The capital improvement plan was published in the Greenfield Recorder on May 30th, 2016, and a public hearing has been held in accordance with Section 10-18 of the bylaws of Deerfield.
Is
earlier this evening.
As you may recall, at the annual town meeting, there was a challenge to some of the procedure behind the motion that was before the town. So those appropriate actions have been taken, and it sits before us again this evening. Any questions or comments from the floor?
John Pereski, chairperson of the Capital Improvement Planning Committee. We recommended that the committee recommended that $2,200 not be spent for the floor of the senior center, and we didn't agree the $4,700 should be spent for a rug in the lounge area, yet I guess the Board of Selectmen feel it should be spent because the appropriation includes those amounts. And I don't think there was any discussion about that. I don't know if it's a mistake or...
It was the request came from the senior center, and the previous Board of Selectmen agreed with the senior center request. So we kept the $57,687, even though I was on the Capital Building Improvement Fund when we voted for this.
The kitchen area, in our opinion, was in pretty good shape, and it had a few holes in the, I don't know if you call it linoleum tile or flooring, but we didn't feel it was that serious. And we felt that the rug could just be steam cleaned instead of spending $4,700 for a whole rug, especially without knowing what's going to be happening to that building as a whole. That was our committee's opinion.
Mr. Pereski, are you offering a motion to amend to the lower amount, or are you just giving comment?
I guess as the chairperson of the committee, I'd have to make a motion to amend.
Can you state that motion?
Pardon?
Can you state the motion?
I'd like to make a motion that the warrant, this article, be changed to $50,787.
Second.
So this is only comment on the amendment at this point. Is there anyone wish to comment on that amendment?
My name is John Pachurik. I think in the Finance Committee we agreed with the Capital Improvement Committee. And if we did, then the Finance Committee agreed with John Pereski.
So comment from the Finance Committee.
And I think there has been more discussion, and there is some question of what is going to occur in the next few months. So I'm reversing my further support for the $57,687 from the initial process this winter.
Is there any comment from the Finance Committee?
Sure. Dylan Corpita, Finance Committee. Yeah, I agree with what Mr. Pachurik said. We did look at this, and we really looked to the Capital Improvements Committee as they spent the time not only on these items, but how these items fit into the larger picture over multi-years and how we want to allocate and prioritize spending. So that was our recommendation, and so I was surprised because I would think that the recommended amount would have been the motion amount, but all that said, we did agree with the $50,787 looking to the Capital Improvements Committee.
So other, yes.
I have a question. My name is Lily White, and I live on South Mill River Road. I just don't understand why, if the logic is that we don't know what's going to happen to the building, we are not going to fix holes in the kitchen and lounge area, but we're going to fix the bingo hall if we don't know what's happening. So I'm just asking if that's the logic, that something's going to come up in the next few months. Why would we put anything in, and why not just do a revisit of the whole thing?
Well, I think this is just my opinion, but the bingo hall the tile is asbestos tile and it's chipping up, so it provides a health risk and potentially, asbestos, as long as it's sealed, it's not a risk to anybody, but once it comes into, airborne, it becomes an issue. So we felt this is for the next fiscal year, 17, that starts July 1st, coming up. So hopefully we'll know what's going on and in the next few months, but we felt that this was a health issue, and so we should move forward with this. There was some possibility that the lounge area could be extended for another year by just steam cleaning the rug. We could squeeze by. And the kitchen itself, not a lot is done in the kitchen. It's because the food is comes from a central hub and is delivered, prepared, pre-prepared, so that it's really a reheating process versus actually preparation, and not a lot of people use the kitchen. So again, we could squeeze by, and it would be better, our money would be better spent further down the line. Unfortunately, we really can't, nothing is solid, so we can't really discuss anything, but it was a health issue, so that's why everyone agreed that the bingo hall, we need to appropriate the money. Whether we actually use it, if things move along fast enough, I don't know. But it will be available, and we felt it was a health risk, so we need to address it.
Point of clarification, Carolyn, this is FY17 money because it's a special town meeting, not FY18 money.
No, 17. Oh, did I say 18? I'm sorry.
Wait, 17.
I meant this year, July 1st.
Ask if there was plans soon to do something about the senior center, because I work for LifePath, formerly Franklin County Home Care, and it's definitely very marked the facilities for seniors in our town compared to some other towns have a lot better facilities. So just the message that it would send to the community as how much we value seniors, unless there's some, it's tagged to some kind of timeline of some improvement.
Well, we don't have a timeline at the moment, but we are definitely, it's a priority. And we are trying to address it. And that's the most I can say at this point.
So currently there's a motion to amend on the floor. Is there any other comment on that motion? All those in favor of the motion to amend the appropriation from $57,687 down to $50,787? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The motion carries. So as the current motion now reads as amended, I'll repeat it for the town. I move the town appropriate $50,787,000 from the Municipal Building Fund for capital projects as specifically set forth in Article 2 of the warrant, a copy of which has been distributed at this meeting, which capital projects and manners are incorporated herein by reference. That's the motion that's now before the town. Any further comments or questions on that? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The motion carries. The third article is an appropriation for capital projects. Member McDaniel.
I move the town appropriate $174,599 from free cash for the capital projects as specifically set forth in Article 3 of the warrant, a copy of which has been distributed at this meeting, which capital projects and manners are incorporated herein by reference.
Second.
Second.
This request for capital expenditures is reviewed and recommended by the Capital Improvements Committee in accordance with the town's five-year capital improvement plan. The capital improvement plan was published in the Greenfield Recorder on May 30th, 2016, and a public hearing has been held in accordance with Section 10-18 of the bylaws of Deerfield.
Similar to the previous article, this was a matter that was before the annual town meeting. There was a challenge as to whether proper procedure had been followed prior to the vote. It was withdrawn at that time, and it's back before the town this evening. Any comments or questions?
Finance Committee,
do you have any comment?
We recommended these appropriations. Again, we spoke with and to the different departments that these projects had to do with, and also looked to the Capital Improvements Committee, who spent a lot of time going through this and felt that these were in line both with needs and also with our goal to try to prioritize capital investment into different town departments and areas.
Does the Capital Improvement Committee have any comment? Any other comments? Yes.
Just one comment. Are they trading in equipment versus additional?
Trading.
Thank you, Kevin.
Yes.
On the capital improvement list, it shows the defibrillator updates at 19,000, and on the Article 3, it lists 20,500. What is the difference there?
John, you have the pricing?
So the defibrillator units for the police department are currently 14 years old. Their life expectancy is 10 years. Right now, when I looked at the police department, I realized that nobody in the town was really monitoring the other units, such as the town hall or anywhere else. So it made no sense as a public safety official to put in for police department only. So what I did is looked at all the town buildings, all the defibrillators. We're trading in about 6 or 7 units. 1 or 2 of them are junk. We're upgrading to 11 units. And the current quote that we got was about $20,400. That is not 11 units for the police department. I am simply spearheading this. This is town hall, the police department, the senior center, the library, the highway garage. So all town buildings will have them easily and accessible.
Fine.
John?
Okay.
It's 20,500, not 19,500, right?
It's 20,004 and change. Yes.
Thank you.
Any other comment? All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. On Article 4, which is the structured tax agreement for the solar photovoltaic project. Selectman Member Ness?
I move to authorize the Board of Selectmen to enter into a tax agreement with Lake Street Development Partners, LLC, in accordance with the terms of the agreement, a copy which has been distributed at this meeting is attached hereto and is included herein by reference.
Is there a second?
This agreement ensures the success of the renewable energy project, guarantees a source of income for the town, provides the developer with a predictable schedule for property, personal property tax. And I would like to take a moment to thank John Cordair, who did a tremendous amount of work to make this happen in time for this special town meeting.
Did you hear that, John?
Next year. Yes.
You can leave this, John? No. I've got a lot here. I just wanted to let you know that I wasn't the only one involved in this, although I became involved kind of late in the negotiation stage. But I would have to thank, first of all, our former town administrator and our current town administrator, Doug, who did an awful lot of work on this. So, anyway, what I just want to let you know is that over the 20-year span of this agreement, we are going to collect the same amount of taxes as if we didn't enter into this agreement. Now, the reason for this is these people want to invest something over $9 million, close to $10 million, into this project. This is a big solar project. It doesn't affect the town in terms of children in schools, plowing roads, no services. So it's a good deal for the town. We had to negotiate the value of what these solar panels were going to be. And they've come down an awful lot in the last few years. We're importing panels from Japan and China, who knows where. But we finally reached an agreement that we think is viable for the town, and we did an alternative value approach. And the alternative value approach was based upon what's known as the income approach. And based upon the income approach,
Lake Street development is going to be limited to 4,400 kilowatt hours to pass to the grid. That's their agreement with Eversource. And we've got, I've got so many papers that you can't believe how long I've worked on this. But we finally valued it at a little over $9 million. And if we went the tax route, the first year would see a tremendous amount of increase in taxes for them. I mean, it would be something like $78,000 they would have to pay, maybe more. I've forgotten without looking at my paperwork. But their investors are looking to keep that level throughout the 20 years. And based upon that, we negotiated a 62,000, I think it is.
Yes, that's correct, John.
$62,000 a year payment from them instead of going like 100 and something thousand in the first year. Is it there?
142.
There it is. Thank you, Bob. 142,000 in the first year. So, this levels it out for them and helps their investors and helps them get financing to get this project going. It's a good project for the town. I certainly hope you would approve it.
Any questions for Mr. Kader before he sits? For the town or for Mr. Kader?
I'm sorry, no, on the subject. Just in general about the two.
Sure. One moment. Thank you, Mr. Kader. Go ahead.
My name's M.A. Sweelock. I was a physical product. My name is M.A.
Right there.
That's working. Nope, it's not.
Still working on. The switch on.
My name is M.A. Sweelock, and I am a past member of the Energy Committee. And Chris, as is Kristen Bacher, who is working on that. We think this is a good project. I think it is probably a real benefit to the town, but we just sort of heard about it last week. I mean, we knew it was in the mix, but the details, we just heard about it. And so we had a few questions. Can you all hear me?
It's working.
The mic is.
Okay, I'll try the mic.
Now can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. So my first question is, has the select board made any specific commitments to Lake Street? Because it looks to me, as I read the article, that we are authorizing you to go into an agreement. And so I was wondering if, regarding either the net metering credits or the pilot, if we authorize you to enter into an agreement tonight, will you still be able to negotiate with them additionally, or is this basically a rubber stamp on the whole agreement?
Is your question in regard to the tax agreement or in regard to the underlying agreement?
Well, it's actually on both of them. I don't know really what the history, what's happened. Okay. So my question is, if you can, if there's still negotiation room and we're just authorizing for these, both of these, to have additional negotiations, then the rest of my questions may be significant. But if there's no negotiation room, I guess I have some real concerns. So that's sort of where I'm at.
I would feel more comfortable if Lisa and John were able to answer your questions.
Okay. Sure. Lisa Mead, Town Council. As to the tax agreement, the statute requires the Board of Selectmen and the assessors to negotiate the agreement and have town meeting approve the agreement. So this agreement has been negotiated.
Okay.
And the town meeting is approving the agreement as presented. So that's what the statute authorizes, and that's what's happened, and that's what John and the Board of Selectmen, Casey and Doug, have been working on this since the fall.
Yeah.
And so that agreement is done. The net metering agreement, or the power purchase agreement, was also, it's on private land, it's private property. It was done under the exemption under 30B. And so that agreement also has been negotiated and is done. So we're really looking on that one for the town to give its affirmation, again, not to negotiate or change the agreement. It's merely, it's a 20-year agreement. It's exempt under 30B, and the Board of Selectmen are in here for the affirmation on it.
Okay, did you want to? It begs the question, if it's a 20-year agreement, that's a long-term agreement. I checked out the warrant online on the town site, and there was no reference to the signed document that's here, nor the description in italics under Article 4. So I don't know what protocol is, but if the town is going to approve your negotiations, I would think you would need to notify the town what those negotiations have resulted in.
Yes. Chairperson asked, has this matter been discussed at select board meetings? Is that correct? Or?
Well, yes. Mr. Moderator, if I may. Actually, under Article 4, it very specifically says what the agreement is, and it says that a copy of it is on file at the town clerk's office. Very specifically does say that.
Yeah, right. I see that. I looked at the online version. It's kind of retro for me to come and pick up a town warrant. And online, that wasn't there.
Okay, I can't.
Is that?
It's in this booklet that was in the back. Okay. And it was on file.
Okay. Well, for future reference, for people who like to get their information online, I would think it would be fair to the public in the town to have that information online so they don't have to drive down to the town hall to get it.
Yes.
Thank you.
I agree.
Is there anyone else that has any comment? We can come back to you, but let's get some other voices heard. Go ahead.
Yes, Bruce Hunter, Sand Gully Road, South Deerfield. In the article, it states for a period of up to 25 years.
That's correct.
Just like a clarification on that. And also, I have a concern on the potential default on payment. Because this article reads that this agreement can be assigned to some other party, and they might, in some point, go out of business. So then there would be no payment. So my concern is, do we have the protection needed in our contract?
Town Council.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. So the warrant article, when it was originally drafted, was drafted for the annual town meeting. At the time, the agreement wasn't finished, and so it was up to 25 years, but the agreement itself is actually for 20 years. And secondly, the agreement applies to successors and assigns, and if they default, then the property owner would, not the property owner, but the developer would be required to pay the taxes as due, as if there were no agreement in place.
Even if the
That's correct.
If the developer goes under also, what happens?
If the developer, just like any other personal property tax bill, is responsible for the personal property taxes. That's correct.
I was wondering if this project is grandfathered under the current state regulations in relation to net metering credits. This is about net metering. Should you want me to wait?
Yes.
Okay.
Please.
I have a general concern, and that is when the town has agreed to being a host to this installation, we provided Lake Street the ability to increase their profits by almost threefold. They can both increase the size of the system from 2 megawatts to 6 megawatts, and they will receive full value of the net metering. Does the town receive any compensation for this service?
That's a PPA, that's not a tax agreement. That's a question for your PPA, right? That's not a tax agreement question.
I don't know, it depends on what, you know, where you might negotiate the compensation.
Well, the Well, the tax agreement is based upon the personal property that's being constructed, which is estimated at, the size of the facility is estimated at, I think what John just said.
5.99.
Right. So the tax agreement has a provision that, in fact, if it's larger, the tax assessors have a right to go back in and reassess it and add to it. If it's smaller, they have a right to go back in and reduce it. So there's an inspection period and a reassessment period depending on the size of the project under the tax agreement.
And, okay.
Yes, sir.
Fred Moore. I just wondered if there's any is there any income from the, you know, like a penny per kilowatt hour or something like that from the output of the, because we're,
That's an issue for the next article. That's the that's under the PPA, net metering agreement, not the tax agreement.
Okay, is that going to be on tonight or
yes.
another?
Next one, the next one.
Article. Comment only on the tax agreement. Mr. Decker?
Mr. Moderator, I want to point out, it's my understanding, this only covers the fixtures and what have you, the personal property. Value of the real estate that's underneath this solar farm will probably go up in value, and we can probably expect an increase in the assessment for the land itself. Am I incorrect?
I would like to point out that they are leasing the land. They do not own the land. But in all likelihood, Mr. Decker is correct, it probably will necessitate some increase in value because it's a change in use.
And the tax agreement only applies to the personal property, that is correct.
It does not apply to the landowner.
I just want to make sure everybody understands.
Yes.
My name is Ava Gibbs, and I live at 617 River Road. This is a side note, which I already talked to Carolyn about, but I want to put on record just a small thing that I don't know how we can do this, but I want to ask this Lake Street to not have their trucks come down River Road either way, because as in the building of it. And maybe even in maintenance. I know this has nothing to do with the taxes or the net metering, but I just want it on record because we get a lot of traffic that doesn't need to be there. They can just walk, go around. Can we ask them to do that?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much.
Sir?
Hi, my name is David Gilbert Keith, and I'm the current chair of the Energy Committee. And I would really like to address both articles, Article 4 and 5. I actually think Article 4 is a pretty good deal.
So let's just leave it at that. If we can recognize you again, Article 5, I really want to stay on task with this.
All right, but I do want to bring up the general point that we have a landfill that was being considered as an alternative site for development, and this does potentially impact it. And I owe the town an apology because I, for various reasons, including medical, have been kind of out of commission for 4 months and haven't been following this. So I do understand it's late to be coming to the game, but there is an issue of how much this solar development impacts our ability to develop the landfill property, which could potentially bring in more benefit to the town financially. On the other hand, we have a bird in the hand here, and I feel remiss, and I apologize for not being more on top of it, but there are a lot of questions, and I'm very sorry that the answer to the question about whether things have been signed is as it is. To me, I would love to authorize the town to go ahead with this. I think that authorizing further discussion is fine. Authorizing the agreement as it stands gives Lake Street an awful lot for what the town is giving them. we are giving them the potential to earn a whole lot more than they would without the town's participation. And for instance, they could only build a 2-megawatt system without the town being the host. So already they'd be getting a third of what they're getting. And we're not getting a third back. They're taking the risk and so on. The reason I think the current article question is a good deal is that it doesn't depreciate. It's a pretty set value, and it's a pretty good one. So I guess I'm saying that the consideration of the whole thing depends on how much you want to develop the landfill. And we may be blowing that away. And we also may wind up paying more for the value of the electricity we buy that is not covered. We're buying 500,000 kilowatts of credits.
Thank you, sir. So again, let's just keep the comment on to the tax agreement. All Mr. Kadir, thank you for your comments. Mr. Kadir, do you have a comment on the tax agreement or on the general proposition?
Well, I'm what his question was. During my negotiations with the Lakeside Development people, they are very interested in developing another solar array at the town landfill. Now, obviously, if they don't get this, they're going to walk away. But that shouldn't be the overriding decision. I agree that the landfill should be. It would be a great place for a solar array. And Lakeside is very interested. We'll see what happens. There's always a risk, but we'll see what happens in the future.
Further comment on the tax agreement only. I call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Article 5 represents a net metering credit sales agreement. But we can now be directly commented on.
I move that the town authorize the Board of Selectmen to enter into a net metering power purchase agreement with Lake Street Development Partners, LLC, LSDP, with respect to LSDP's planned solar voltaic electric generating facility to be located at 901 River Road for up to 25 years in accordance with the terms of the agreement, a copy of which has been distributed at this meeting, is attached hereto and incorporated herein with reference.
Second.
Finance Committee, have any comment?
We did not. We weren't really a part of this negotiation, but thought it was in good hands of the people working on it.
This agreement, as negotiated with the Select Board and the developer, will allow the town to purchase up to 500,000 kilowatts of net metering credit at a discount rate from the developer, which can be used to offset the full cost of up to 500,000 kilowatts of the town's electric use. This net metering credit purchase agreement will provide fiscal stability to the developer and provide the town with a savings on its energy cost. A copy of the negotiated agreement is on file with the town clerk and is available for public review.
I'd just like to make a comment.
The Select Board is very interested in doing the landfill. It's been very frustrating that we have not been able to get this done at the landfill. So that's one of the things that we will be working on very hard and pursue. As John indicated, it looks like we have a good chance of getting it done.
Yes, sir.
I have a question on the discounted rate, the 20%. Is the 20%, does it have a range on what the electric kilowatt hour cost is? As an example, if it goes below a certain kilowatt, cents per kilowatt hour, do we lose the 20% discounted rate?
I can speak to that if you'd like. Okay.
The agreement as negotiated is a 20% discount purchase price off of both the generation and transmission charge the generation and the transmission payment that Eversource would make to the developer. So that applies Regardless of what the price is, the percentage stays at 20%, with a caveat. We are bound by the contract to pay no less than 7.5 cents per kilowatt hour for transmission and generation, all told. If transmission and generation drop below, rough math, 9.5 cents, we start to get a little bit less than that 20% benefit. The last time electricity was at 7.5 cents a kilowatt hour, I believe Reagan was in office, and I think it was his first term. The last time, to get the full 20%, we need to get at least 9.5 cents per kilowatt hour. The last time electricity was that low, it was George Bush the first. It was the early 1990s. Electricity since has gone as high as 16 cents and as low as about 10.5 cents, but never below that.
Just to follow up, I believe the published rate for this summer is below 10 cents.
Remember that it's not only the generation charge, but also the transmission charge as well. So the benefit, the net metering credit, is actually slightly better than the actual, just the generation charge.
And the net metering credit is based on what the residential rate is?
It is based on a formula that's established by Eversource, that's governed by the Department of Public Utilities. It is different from what residents pay. If you were to have an array at your house and to do net metering at your house, you would actually get a better deal than the town is able to. However, it's still, that amount is still expected to be at about 10.5 or 11 cents right in that neighborhood right now, given current prices. So,
yes, sir.
Reed Predmore again. I just offer a correction. I think it should be 500,000 kilowatt hours. Because that's what we get billed at, isn't kilowatt hours?
You're absolutely correct. 500,000 kilowatt hours over the course of a year. That's what the town would purchase.
So is this per year or over 20 years?
This is each year for 20 years, yes.
Okay, so that at if the electricity and transmission costs were 20 cents a kilowatt hour, that's, and 20% of that is 4 cents, that's going to be about $20,000 per year.
In benefit to the town, correct.
Right. And considering the amount of electricity they're going to be generating, that seems like a pretty small amount. I think it would be better if we negotiated something like a penny a kilowatt hour that they're generating, their gross generation. $20,000 is not that much money considering the size of the electricity output. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have a couple of questions. In this agreement, we are a host, a municipal host for the solar facility, which allows Lake Street to build a larger array, not 2 megawatts, but 6 megawatts, as MA alluded to. This is a point I'm not sure on, and so it's one of my questions. So we're only going to take 500,000 kilowatt hours, and a 6 megawatt is going to produce, I forget how many, but much more than that. I think you said in the negotiations that Eversource agreed to take a set amount, 4,000 kilowatt hours, was it?
I'm sorry, what's your question?
How much is Eversource agreeing to take?
4,400 kilowatt hours.
And of the 4,400 kilowatt hours a year, or what you said, 4,400?
No, let me allow a correction if I may. Yes. Excuse me, the net metering cap for the array is set at 4.4 megawatts.
Right.
So whatever they can generate up to that cap is what Eversource has agreed to take to grant in net metering credit.
So not kilowatt hours, we're talking.
No, it's they've accepted
megawatts.
Correct. They've accepted the array and its generation size.
Now, other buyers, which is the point I was trying to get to, we're only a small fraction of the buyers for the amount of energy produced.
Lake Street will have to contract with other buyers for the balance. Is it true that the other buyers need to be municipalities because it's hosted by a municipality?
I believe that the other buyers do not need to be municipalities.
It's an important point because there's only a limited number of municipalities who can take on that or may be willing to take on to that contract, because when we were looking at the landfill, Bernie Kubiak called around to other municipalities to see how many would be willing to buy if we did a solar facility on our landfill, and we couldn't get enough, and we said there's no way we're going to go forward with being responsible for finding municipalities to buy this energy, because it has to be municipalities within our district. Can't be from New Hampshire or Vermont. so that's one important point. The other ramification of that is that if we did it on the landfill and we were also a municipal host and were required to get contracts from other municipalities, they might be dried up by that time, which would make it more difficult to get buyers for energy produced at the landfill, which would make it a less viable investment. So that's why I'm asking that question. The other question is, because we've taken on the municipality host responsibility, what are the potential downsides of that? What are the risks of that? I don't know, but I would hope the question has been asked.
The risk to the town on this is that they have to use the 500,000 kilowatt hours per year.
Right.
That's the town's risk. They have to use that, period.
Okay, so being a host doesn't have any other responsibilities?
No, not under this contract.
Well, I don't know if it's not. What about the state regulations? No?
No, that's addressed.
Okay, terrific. Okay, my other question is that if we would be buying roughly half our power through this facility. I believe the town uses about 1,000 kilowatt hour, 1,000, I'm sorry.
A million.
1 million, thank you. And half of 1 million is the 500, so about half. Who would we be required to purchase the balance from? Could we negotiate with HCOG for that, or would we have to buy from Eversource for that balance?
We are not bound to a given electric generator for our purchasing of electricity. We currently buy our electric through HCOG, and that can continue under this agreement, and we can choose a different electric generator at any time,
okay.
Electric source provider at any time.
So what is our commercial rate right now with HCOG?
I looked at a bill today. It's just under 10 cents for the generation charge. The transmission charge added another 2 cents or so per kilowatt hour for about 12 cents per kilowatt hour.
So about 12 cents.
Yeah.
And what is Eversource's, do you know?
Slightly higher.
Slightly higher. Okay.
We are getting a slightly better deal with HCOG.
Okay.
I think it's around 13.5 cents.
From Eversource, for commercial.
Yeah. The last we checked.
Okay.
When John started negotiating this, just before town meeting, so it was about 6 weeks ago.
Okay.
Ma'am, I think the town, there's other people that wish to speak, and we've got a flavor of the dialogue, so if we can just move along. If you have other questions, you can come back up.
But sure, thanks.
Thank you. Ma'am? If you want to come to the microphone, behind you.
Lori Busato, 193 North Main Street. I just want to speak in a little bit of a generality here. We have solar panels, so I've been following the net metering legislation a little bit. And the state has recently got a ruling from the Supreme Judicial Court that they need to follow the mandate of the Global Warming Global Warming Solutions Act. So if the conflict over can we do the landfill and the site has to do with whether or not the utilities will be required to buy electricity from community shared solar and something like that, I think it's all of our in all of our favor to keep pushing the legislature to make as much solar available as possible. We all so wonderfully pat your neighbor on the back, fought the new pipeline. So we need to say yes to alternatives. And I hear people asking specific details, and we should all become educated enough to know the details, and we should get a good deal. But I don't know that if we were talking about should we use a gas-fired plant or a natural gas-fired plant, I don't know that we would be as picky. I think it's the newness of this, and I think it's the right direction to go. So I would like us to be pushing for both and more beyond. So.
May I ask a follow-up really quickly? Ma'am, would you like to be on the Solar Energy Committee, please?
Yes.
Please, thank you. Check in with David later.
Any other comments?
I do have one more question, and it's just a question at this point to the attorney. If we are the host to this facility, can we be a host to the landfill facility?
Yes.
Great. Okay.
Any other comment? Call. Ma'am.
At the state level, it's state regulations, the legislation, the omnibus energy bill, all of these things are
here.
Can you hear me? It's off again?
No, it's on.
It's on.
You just need to speak closely to it.
I should speak louder?
Yeah.
Ah, okay. Where energy, net metering, all of these things, SRECs, all of these things are going is completely in flux. And my question is, will this facility be grandfathered if we sign this agreement, will it be grandfathered for the 20 years of the net metering, or will, if the legislature changes the rules on net metering, will we be subject to those changes?
Just like the other, the prior agreements that have been signed in the last 5 years, even 7.5 years.
Right.
Once those are signed and somebody has an interconnection agreement, they're locked in under the rules at the time.
Right. And so right now we have a set of regulations. 6 months from now, we don't know what those regulations are going to be.
But so I don't know. Doug is going to have to answer the question about where they are on the interconnection approval. But once this is signed and they have the interconnection approval, they are locked in. So I don't know where they are in that process or on the list.
Lake Street Development has secured their cap and their SREC allocation. They're locked in.
So they're on the list.
They're already on the
list.
They're
list.
Locked in under the current.
Under SREC 2 and the current regulations. Excellent. Absolutely.
That's great.
Mr. Becker? Thank you.
I think that's all.
Mr. Moderator, did I hear somebody explain to us before that we had to approve the prior article, but this one was here basically for affirmation?
That is correct.
This agreement, this net metering thing is already in effect.
This is exempt from 30B, and the select board wished to put this before the town meeting for conversation and hopefully for the town's approval, but it does not require it in order
to. But we're already stuck with it.
We've already entered into it, yes.
That's my point.
Any other comment? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The motion carries. Article 6 is the approval to apply for grants for the Tilton Library. I'm going to ask Nancy Maynard to come forward to address.
Hi, I'm Nancy Maynard, Chairman of the Board of Trustees.
Talk right into that mic, please.
I move that the Deerfield Select Board be authorized to apply for, accept, and expend any state grants which may be available for the addition and renovation of the Tilton Library, 75 North Main Street.
Second.
I'd like to briefly comment on it.
This article will allow the Deerfield Select Board and the Tilton Library Board of Trustees to apply for grants relative to the proposed renovation of the Tilton Library. This action does not commit the town to completing the renovations, nor does it appropriate any money to the project. A copy of the proposed renovation is on file with the town clerk and is available for public review.
Are there any questions specifically for Nancy? Thank you, Ms. Maynard. Are there any comments on the underlying motion?
Yes, Bruce Hunter again. The article actually authorizes the trustees to apply, and the motion authorizes the Deerfield Select Board to apply and receive grants and expend funds. I'm just curious, is it the town going to take the role, lead role in this project?
The motion, which would control this evening, is correct. So it is the select board. Yes.
I'm Jack Davey. I'm on the Capital Improvement Planning Committee, and I live on Upper Road. We have a question regarding the, I guess, a legal question. The bylaws, Chapter 19, Section 10, state that no appropriation shall be voted for capital improvement requested by a Department of Water Commission unless the proposed improvement is considered in a capital improvement implementation or until the committee has provided its recommendation thereon. And so since the capital improvement committee has not been presented with any, might it be true that no vote should be taken on this article because of the word expend? We're authorizing the select board not just to apply for the grants, but also to expend the money. And so that's my question.
Thank you, Mr. Davey.
The expenditure of this authorization is not an appropriation because it's a grant. So it's not an appropriation.
So in other words, spending of grants for whatever purpose do not have to be first presented to the Capital Improvement Committee as Chapter 19 seems to say?
It says appropriation, and there's a difference. And in fact, there are many grants that the selectmen can get and spend without approval of town meeting or any other body. Similarly, there are grants that the Board of Trustees could get that would not require an appropriation.
Sir?
The grant is only 50%, approximately 50% of the total cost of the project. So at some point in time, there will be an appropriation for the remaining, and I believe that's where it might have to come to.
That comes through town meeting.
That's correct. If there's any funds that have to come through town meeting to be raised and appropriated, it would have to follow the process which the member has outlined. And this, any grants received under this particular thing would only cover a portion of what's being sought, and therefore would naturally have to come back to town meeting.
Yes.
By accepting a grant, are we committing to having to spend the money in the future? If it's like, 50% grant, and they enter into the contract for the grant, are we committed to do our 50%?
So I don't have the grant language here. I think the OPM could answer that question, but here's my gut. You're going to have to sign a contract for the grant, which will require you to have the match. And so, therefore, you couldn't sign it until you had the match. But I'll let Mr. Pallotta have. Is that correct?
Mr. Pallotta, if you can come to a microphone or speak loudly. Mr. Pallotta is from Project Planning Professionals, who is involved in the grant, in the project, I should say.
Thank you. thank you for allowing me to speak. There are three votes that are going to be required for this project.
The first two are tonight. One is to accept the grant. The grant is subject to you appropriating your portion. Since we don't have hard figures on the grant, we don't know what your portion will be. Since we don't know what year the grant will be granted, we don't know what your portion will be. We will have 6 months when the grant is awarded to the town to do the appropriation. So you'll have the opportunity to go through the normal steps and procedures within your bylaws for the appropriation. Accepting the grant does not mean you have to spend the grant. Accepting the grant is invalid if you do not appropriate the money. So the two votes tonight are procedural votes that do not have an effect if the third vote, the appropriation vote, does not occur.
Thank you.
I just want to add that this cycle is an 8 to 10 year cycle, so we don't know where, if we get accepted on the list, we don't know where on the list. We could be in the front, we could be in the middle, and we could be in the tail end. It's a cycle that the library group goes through every year, every 8 to 10 years. So this is to see where on the list if we get accepted and where on the list we are. It's why it was very difficult to have it on the capital improvement plan because we don't know how far out it's going to be.
Mr. Upton?
Yes, I'd just like to make a comment. This has me a little concerned, because it's almost like a replay of what we ran into with the school roof without knowing numbers and that. And, I understand where people are coming from. Obviously, just looking at the crowd tonight, it's going to pass. So, you probably want to hang me. That's okay. But I'm still going to make the comment. I'm a little concerned because it's almost like we're heading down the road like we did with the school roof. And we're going to pursue this grant, get the grant possibly at the 50%, and then we're going to be chasing after, I think a timeline was 6 months or something, we're going to be chasing after trying to match funds in that. And that puts us again under a real strict timeline, and it leaves us shuffling as far as, is this really the best decision for the town? And, I did go to the presentation the other night. One of my concerns as far as the town, and this is a little off base maybe, but is that again it seems like we're addressing each concern or issue individually in this town instead of the big picture. And again, you come into a cost factor. It'd be nice if we could be a little more cost efficient in the town. And when I say that, once again, I bring up the senior center in their needs, the library, their needs, and here we are in a situation where we're not even considering a multi-purpose building. And yet the library is proposing, which is fine, they're proposing an 80-person community room with a kitchen. And I realize that the grant has some restrictions on what can be spent, what cannot be spent. I understand that. But at the same time, as a town, do we need to really step back and take a look at the bigger picture? My concern is, are we going down the same road that we did with the school roof? And, that was a need. There's no question about it. But was that the most cost-effective way of doing it? Because we put ourselves under a time constraint. And that's my concern.
Yes.
Julie Cavaco, North Hillside Road. I'm also the children's librarian.
It's on. Just talk louder.
Just talk closer.
It's on.
Just talk closer.
Can you hear me now?
Not really. Right into it.
It's on.
Hey, I'll talk like I do at home. Julie Cavaco, North Hillside Road. I'm also the children's librarian. My kids are all grown up, and I've been in town 31 years, and so I was here for the school votes and the everything. And one of the things that I've observed about the library is that the trustees, and someone correct me if I'm wrong, has the ability to fundraise on their own. Yes. And so no other department can, let's have a bake sale, let's have a plant sale, can raise money to go towards their projects. So that's one thing that I want to address. We've got a very active group of trustees, and I see really solid support. When we do our annual fund, I don't know what's in the envelopes, but we get a nice bunch of envelopes with our address on it that I see in the mailbox. That's just an observation. And addressing the community room, one of the reasons why I wanted that included and is because I've been doing community suppers for the last 2 years, and I've been using a church hall. Everybody thinks it's connected to the church, but it's really just for the purpose of the town. Everything we do is related to the Polish Club or a church. This facility doesn't have a kitchen, so we don't have the option of using a space outside of these private institutions. And Monday Night Music will have 80 people at it, and if it's a rainy day, then it holds back the amount of people that come. The Friday Night's Frolics could use the space. I just see the meeting space, community space, as being a really viable option for really creating community in our town. And she's right. The children room is bursting. So thank you for your consideration.
Yes, I'm not arguing that point at all. In fact, what I'm saying is it's actually a very good design. But once again, why can't it serve the purpose of two needs for the town? We have a senior center here that we're going to have to sink in some serious money or do something differently. Also, it's not just the cost of building a building, it's the cost of maintaining a building. And where's that money coming from? Also, the furnishings within the building. I mean, we're not talking a small dollar amount here. I think we're talking considerable money, and it would be nice to be able to, with the same dollars, be able to fulfill the needs of two portions of your community together in one. And if you're really talking a community building, then let's make it a real community building. And that's my concern. Why are we doing, and I understand what people are saying about a want for the library and the expansion. That's not the issue here. But what I'm saying, there's also a need for a senior center.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Mary Cloutier, 17 Sugarloaf. I think it's important not to pit these needs against each other. The grant is specifically for libraries. We can't building as much as we would all like to. I think we all recognize that the needs of the senior center are real. No one's trying to say, let's build a library instead. I think if we all had a magic wand, we would build the library that served as the senior center, but that's not what this grant's about. It's gonna be another 10 years before this grant cycle comes around again, and it would be saying no to 50% of our library being paid for over an issue that's not connected to it.
One more comment, please. Not to bring up a sore point, but I think planning is very important, and I'll put it out there, and people can get mad at me if they want, but here we have, and it's a great design, as I said before, but correct me if I'm wrong, we just spent some serious money on the granite steps in front of the library, CPA money, and it was a fairly good chunk of money, and now with that design, that goes by the wayside. Let me finish. Those steps are not going to be your main entrance, are they? They're going to be simply an emergency egress from what my understanding was from the meeting the other night. So I'm not saying it was wasted money. Maybe that money could have been just planned a little more efficiently.
Ms. Woodward?
A little more efficiently.
Hi, my name is Judy Holmes. I live on Hillside Road. I'm also the co-chair, along with Dave Lamb, of the planning committee for library renovation project. And I just wanted to clarify a couple of things which have already been said, but I just think it bears repetition. The Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners grant is very, very clear that those funds can only be spent on library buildings. None of those funds can be spent on a building that's being built for any other purpose, such as a senior center. I concur with the comment over here that I think all of us in town understand the senior center needs, but using a Board of Library Commissioners grant to fulfill senior center needs is just not possible. The other thing is that this money that we're applying for, this pool of grant money, is coming from the Massachusetts legislature. And the Massachusetts legislature gets its money from us, the taxpayers. So this is a pool of money that's available to our town. And I think what we were trying to do is to make sure that Deerfield gets its share of that money that's going into the MBLC granting cycle. We're trying to make sure as many resources as we can are brought to this town, rather than trying to diminish it. Thank you.
I think there's some very good points about the use of the grant money, and that is important, and that's what it can be used towards. But the problem is the other half. I mean, I've heard numbers thrown around about $5 million. So fine, the $2.5 million can only be used for the library. That's great, and that's a very good reason to look into this sort of project. The problem is the other $2.5 million is coming from the taxpayer. And as much as we'd like to not put this in competition with things like the senior center or senior housing or new schools or anything like that, they are in competition. There's only so many $2.5 million projects to go around. And if we can't find a way to spend those bullets wisely, to either have them be commingled multi-purpose efforts or regionalizing where you're having cost savings across towns, I think it's very challenging to see how we're going to get through all our needs over the next 10 or 20 years, given the ability to come up with these big numbers every so often. And that's the challenge. It's not about if people support the library, we do. It's right now the way we're choosing our priorities is whoever comes in first, not what's most important. And that's the challenge.
Again, motion on applying for grants. Yes.
It just seems to me that this motion is about gathering information. And we should not be fearful of gathering information to decide what to do in the future. We're not talking about $2.5 million today. We're talking about gathering information for the future. And we're letting this whole debate seems like we're letting a fear the future go stop that information. And we really shouldn't be running from an information.
I just quickly respond. It's not the fear of the unknown future. It's the reality of how these processes work, how we just saw with the school roof, and how a lot of towns across the area are handling these things, where there's very short time frames with match funding that we just can't afford to give it up because it's 50% or 40% or 80%, and so it gets pushed through. That's why it is a reality. We're seeing this over and over again, and I think we need to be careful about spending. We're choosing to spend a lot of time and effort and focus of a lot of town employees, committees, and townspeople to do this instead of do other things. So there's an opportunity cost as well.
Mr. Becker.
This article is applying the grant. Okay, assuming that passes, does the town also have to approve this design at this point in time? Table that, and when the grant gets approved, then we can come back and try to fast track it and do it. But I think a lot of people are very reluctant to approve the designed at this point when the House of Dollars is all being worked out.
Mr. Pelota, can you address that question directly? Yes, please.
If I may, Mr. Moderator, can I just give the town meeting a brief of the process?
Yes.
So there's no confusion. The MBLC process requires that the town of Deerfield submit a letter of intent in September. Between September and October, the library director, some of the trustees, the OPM, and the designer will be going to a series of workshops on crafting the actual grant using the material that your committee has put together in the past year. That gets submitted on January 15th, 2017. The grant list will be listed in July of 2017. Nothing is going to occur between now and July of 2017. They're expecting 34 libraries to apply. They're expecting to fund 8 to 10 in the first year. You're going to know where you are on the list of 34. If you're not in the first 8 to 10, you're not only going to have 6 months to prepare for your vote, you're going to have at least a year and 6 months to prepare for your vote. So this is a process and a procedure that has worked since 1986 with the MBLC, where they produce the whole list, and as towns get funded, the list gets shorter and shorter and shorter. With regard to the two votes, there are three votes you need. The vote is to approve the schematic design. Schematic means scheme. It's a design that correlates to the building program that the town of Deerfield put together for the needs of a library 20 years from today. So this all-encompassing document and the scheme that you see coming in are being voted on. The actual design will occur when you go to design development and construction document stage. After you fund the project, that design can change a little. We've got a lot of input from people on things that they want to change, and that will occur after the appropriation. This is just to allow the town to apply for the grant, and that the town recognizes what the scheme for the library is through the schematic design. You need both voted prior to the July 17. I'm sorry, no, July. You can not have the votes for applying, but you have to have the votes prior to the announcement of the grant, because some towns don't have special town meetings. They recognize that they'll be hitting their annual town meetings after the applications go in. It is wiser to submit it with, and your committee recognizes this, because those applications that have their votes completed will go higher on the list and be funded sooner. The sooner you're funded, the less unknown there is as to the cost. None of us here know what's going to happen in 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. So the object for the town of Deerfield was to identify the need and move as quickly as possible to getting all of the boxes checked on the grant application. And two of those boxes are these two votes.
Well, Mr. Pilato's on the floor. Any questions regarding the process only?
You could do that, all right, as long as the articles that have to be in by June 15th, I believe. I don't remember. It's a date in June. The grant announcements are in July of 17. You can do that, but you are putting your town at a slighter disadvantage, because the grant reviewers are going to be reviewing the grant applications January, February, and March. And they're certainly going to see a tab with the vote of the schematic design blank. So, you know, even though it's not required, those reviewers are going to mentally make a note. And, you know, this is something that we've done now. This is the fourth grant cycle for the MBLC. We're advising you as a town, as the professionals hired to help you, to try and get your two votes done prior to the grant application going in January.
What happens if somebody wants to make a lot of design changes? Are everything going to be locked in and not subject to any further review?
The committee can't go off the reservation and make design changes. The committee can change change the building a little, they can change the spaces a little, but the square footages of the need that has been established in the grant application must remain within 5%. So if you have a 200 square foot room for young adults, you can go to 210 or you can go to 190. You can't go to 250 or 140. You can do that. You will have the ability to do that.
You can change the windows, right?
You can exercise that as soon as the grant is approved.
You will exercise that. You would exercise that through the approval process, I would assume, within your town. Okay? When we go for the appropriation, which is whenever we are on the grant, and I can't tell you when that's going to be. Town meeting won't vote the final exact design, the contract documents. The planning board will vote the site. The conservation will vote the water dislocation. Okay? I can't tell you that.
I have a question for you, sir. On that drawing, it shows a glass atrium between the building. If at a later committee date or hearing date we decided to do away with that square footage and get rid of the glass atrium, how would that affect the application process?
I think the question was asked during one of the community meetings that the glass atrium, the glass connector between the old building and the new building, would be cost inefficient to heat and cool, and could that go away? The answer is yes, it can go away. The space can't go away because it's integral to the plan of the library. I mean, behind that glass atrium is spaces that relate to the function of the library.
Yeah, I would hope that our energy
elevated stairwell and you know, circulation desk and so on.
I would hope our energy committee gets together and reviews that plan as well to secure it. But it sure seems to me, given the history of this town, we went through it with the highway garage, we went through it recently with the school roof, and we're heading down the same road again. And this is not speaking against a library at all. It's the process. And as a community, we need to be smarter how we do this. The big picture is, what are we going to be paying for taxes? And it's not just the school roof. It's not just the library. It's where do we put our ambulances? And what do we do with our sewer systems? You know, there's some really big ticket things coming down. And, you know, people might be enjoying $3,000 or $4,000 or $5,000 a year property taxes. Realistically, those could be going to $7,000, $8,000, $9,000, $10,000, and people who are paying $8,000, $10,000 are going to be $12,000, $14,000. And that's in the near future. You give, if this library, you know, has a 20-year life expectancy, you know, you do the numbers what we've paid in property taxes. People could be realistically paying $30,000 a year in property taxes in 20 years.
It's not a 20-year life expectancy. It's designed for 20 years.
I understand that. But what I'm saying is that I think that we need to get together, put our priorities together, even if the library is right up there, and discuss it more on the type of building, the way it's constructed, the size of it, and get a decent number. There's no one in this room that would go to a car dealership and say, I want a new car, I'm going to apply for the loan, and just tell me what it costs later. Well, there might be one or two, but the vast majority is not going to do that. And it's difficult to speak out against something, but you really need to know what it's going to cost. And like Jeff said earlier, we experienced this with the highway garage. You know, we used to have an electric bill of just a few $100 a month. We got a new highway garage. Now it's thousands, you know, and then the insurance that goes along with it and the heating of it. And all of these things have to be calculated in. It's not just the library. And from looking at it, you know, that could be $5-6 million just for that.
I'm not here to argue whether you need a library or not. No. Need a library. I'm here to help you with the process.
Right.
And this process comes every 8 to 10 years. If right. The town of Deerfield chooses not to to submit the application because it didn't do the two votes, you're looking at a minimum of 8 to 10 years before you're eligible for the grant again.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. My name is Bill Mayer, PC. I live at 16 Captain Lathrop Drive. I'm also a member of the Frontier School Committee, so I've been part of several of these. And I hear two concerns. Number one, history. You know, that we've gone down this road and something's happened. But I also know that we're at a point that applying for this is just that. We need to get in the game to be able to look at the next steps. We really do. The second point I'd just like to make is we're a commonwealth. A commonwealth means that we look out for everyone. This, I think, building a new library, not to take care of everything, starts to look for the commonwealth of everyone here. So, thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Are you a registered voter?
I am. Oh,
thank you. Go ahead.
I have a couple questions. Sorry if I stumbled through, but I remember somebody saying something about the grant, something the school, the grant is only every 10 years. Can somebody clarify on that? And then I have something else. Anybody?
What? Can't you?
Again, this, sorry, I can't look at you and talk into this. So this grant money comes from the state, and the state sets up these grant cycles about every 10 years to give money to the Mass Board of Library Commissioners, and there's an assessment or apportionment every year by the state that goes to the MBLC, which is why they can't do them all in one fell swoop. So if we don't apply for this grant, if we don't get an application in January of 2017, that means that we will not be able to put an application in again until the state announces its next funding cycle. And it hasn't even begun to spend the money from this funding cycle yet. So that would be, I think we're looking at 2022 is I think when they were suggesting would be the next funding cycle that would start for library construction. Did I answer your question?
So about every 10 years, you said?
Yes, roughly. Again, it's up to the legislature. They're the ones who have to give the money.
I have nothing against the library. I have nothing against grants. But, if I look at the whole picture of everything, there's a lot of places in town that need improvement. I agree with the library, I think it would be great, but I think that we put ourselves in this position and fine, go over the grant, get the grant, but I think that maybe there's other grants that other parts of the town could try to get, and we try to work towards something that, what other people said, combining something together. I just feel like putting everything out there, and no offense, just for the library, is kind of a stretch. What's next? Let's say you do that. What's the cost of the library? What is the cost, do you think, that the library is going to be?
So I just wanted to say that So we've been involved in this process, those of us, in the trustees and the planning committee, for over 2 years now. And we have been to the select board on numerous occasions letting them know what our plans are and what's been going on. In fact, the planning committee was appointed by the select board. Mark Gilmore, who was on the select board for some time, is on our committee. Ralph is on our committee. So there's plenty of people in the town who have been notified and have been part of our processes so far.
I'm just asking, is there a general idea of the total cost? I'm not looking for you to say.
Right. The difficulty is that we've been very clear that once we get a final estimate, we will have a community meeting and we'll tell everybody what it is and we'll look at the numbers together and we'll think about, what it means and that. We just don't yet have that. Like, for instance, the site, I can't remember what you call it, where they dig the holes in the ground, was just done last week. Borings, yes. And so that may affect the thing. We haven't got those results back yet. So We're at a bit of a disadvantage in that we have to meet the MBLC's requirements, time guidelines. So that's why we're pushing forward at this point to see if we can just go to the next, take the next step. And then, you know, again, when we get the final figures from the MBLC as to how much they're going to give us, we know what the actual cost estimate is going to be. Then we can look around, and maybe there'll be some other proposals at that point that are fully formed for a senior center, for some combined something or other, and we can look at those things together. But we don't have any of those things right now, and what we're trying to do with the library is to create that proposal so that we can present it to the town and this community. And I just want to say that I personally am delighted that there's so many people participating in this conversation today, that we have had several community meetings so far, and we haven't had this kind of a turnout. So, I mean, this is a town meeting.
If you have no idea, like, I mean, I'm not looking for, you know, are we talking $2 million or $4 million?
I think we're talking somewhere between 2 and 4.
$4 million.
Yeah.
So the grant, if you were to get approved for that, would pay for half of that.
No, that's what would be owed after the grant.
Right.
Okay, so my question again, so I kind of got confused there. What's the cost? Grant aside, what's the cost? What's 1 million, 2 million, 5 million, 10 million? What range is that?
Four to eight million.
It's hard to say. I understand.
We're just going to cut the dialogue there. So I, if there's any other, thank you. Yes.
I suggest that they look at a freestanding library with all the square footage and what have you, and not put the addition onto the existing building. Then that one could be declared surplus. Maybe that could become a senior center. It's already got a lift, it's got plenty of room. I know there might be some restrictions in the will, but I'm just saying, don't not look at building a freestanding building. It might be more cost efficient.
I'm going to repeat the motion, and if anyone has any further comment on the motion as it's specifically worded, let's do that. I move that the Deerfield Select Board be authorized to apply for, accept, and expend any state grants which may be available for the addition and renovation of the Tilton Library, 75 North Main Street. So while some of the comments are relating to the next article as well, and it's nice to get them out of the way now, let's stick to this article and see if we can get through it. So is there any other comments on this article? Ms. Cavaco.
This is the first part. Okay. So, as I understand it, if I wanted to run for an office, I would go out and get nomination papers. I would ask people that I don't know for the for their signatures, and they would say, sure, I'll let you go on the ballot. You may not agree with me, but you're giving me the right to end up on the ballot. Our vote tonight, as I understand it, is we're just letting the library go to the next stage. We're not committing money. We're not committing the design as it is right now. It's just that we are allowing the library to go to the next stage, just like you might allow me to be run for office. Doesn't mean you're going to vote for me. It doesn't mean that I'm going to get in. It just means that I can get in the game.
Yes.
I have a point of clarification. As I read the article, it says Deerfield Select Board be authorized to apply for. Does that necessarily require the Board of Selectmen to apply, or just authorize them to apply if they're perfect? Can they make a choice? Yes or no?
That's correct. It authorizes them to apply.
Any further comment? I call the motion. All those in favor? Opposed? The motion carries. Article 7, acceptance of schematic design of the Tilton Library renovation. Again, Ms. Maynard.
Hi. I move that the town accept the schematic design for the addition and renovation of the Tilton Library, 75 North Main Street.
Is there a second?
This article accepts the proposed design for the renovation of the Tilton Library as submitted by the trustees of the Tilton Library. The action does not commit the town to completing the renovations, nor does it appropriate any money to the project Materials related to the proposed addition are included in this packet. See addendum 3.
Mr. Moderator?
Yes.
You just said what I was going to ask you. Materials related to the proposed addition are included in this packet. Does anybody have them?
I don't think so. Where are you, sir? I apologize. In the underlying motion, or?
In the description, you just mentioned it. Materials related to the proposed addition are included in this packet, the addendum number 3. I'm sorry, but I think this is out of order.
I don't believe it's in the motion, so
I don't see it.
I can speak to this, Mr. Moderator.
How can we approve it if we can't see it?
Mr. Finn.
The materials were going to be included in the packet, but the materials were 84 pages of materials. It was the entire study from the library study committee, the space design needs. It included none of the plans. It included none of the elevations. Those materials have been on display here at Town Hall. They've been presented by the Tilton Library Building Committee at least once at a public hearing that I'm aware of, more than once, twice, thank you. We were not able to include the maps in this packet. They are available at the back of the hall and have been available at Town Hall for at least 2 weeks. And again, they were presented by the library. I believe it's the trustees that presented it at a public hearing last week and then at least once before prior to that. So the comment that's in your packet that refers to Addendum 3, it was omitted at the last minute because we simply didn't have the capability to include them. It would have made too large of a packet. And for that, I will take full blame on that. I apologize.
Mr. Moderator, I move that we amend Article 7 to postpone this article to the annual town meeting. Second.
Is there a debate on the So, Mr. Kader, are you asking to amend the motion, or are you asking to lay it on the table until the next meeting?
I'm asking to put it on the table. Thank you, Mr.
Mr. Kader has made a motion to lay Article 7 on the table, meaning that it would be to a date certain, which would be the next annual meeting. That matter is not debatable, but does require a two-thirds vote of the body in order to pass. So at this point, we would call...
A quick clarification. Is this being laid on the table till the next annual town meeting?
Mr. Kader's motion was worded that way, yes.
That the date certain would be, I believe, April 24, 2017.
Point of order, is the motion amended to reflect that date, sir?
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
He's just, Mr. Finn has stated the date of the annual meeting.
Do you want to add the date?
April 24, 2017.
I just want to lay it on the table. I don't care if it comes up at another special or yes.
So Mr. Kader, it's your motion. If you can just restate your motion and the town will act on it. We don't know if you're looking to have it at the next meeting or you just want to lay it on the table.
I would move that we lay this on the table to the next scheduled town meeting.
Thank you, sir.
Can I just ask a question?
A point of order, yes.
Whatever the point is.
But no comment on the underlying.
Wasn't this information out at the regular annual town meeting?
Yes, it was.
It was in the packet at the regular annual meeting.
Yeah.
It was an extra packet.
And the information session. So it's not like this is. Yeah. This information was not.
We're gonna call the vote. Is there a number as to how many voters signed in, Ms. Hancock?
I don't have a total count of voters.
Okay. All those in favor.
Wait.
Favor
stated clearly. Is it no for it or against it?
We're voting on the table.
Voting to put it on the table.
So to place it on the table
meaning
would
no
would
action
be
until the next meeting.
Yes, yes
correct.
Means we don't vote on it, correct? Point of order.
Yes, a yes means that you would you here, not vote on vote the matter will be not deliberated further this evening. A yes is a no, a no is a yes.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. Yeah, well, that's trying to be very clear so people know.
Mr. Kadir's motion is on the floor, so point of order?
No, question on the original motion and the effect of it being tabled.
No. So again, the article was as it was published. The motion, which was specifically made tonight by Ms. Mayrand, is what the vote would be on. That vote is being requested to be tabled, meaning there no action would be taken on it this evening. So a yes vote would mean that you are asking that it not be voted on further this evening. All those in favor? All those opposed? The motion is defeated, and Article 7 will proceed. We do have a two-thirds in opposition. So back to the underlying motion. Is there further discussion on the underlying motion, which was that I move the town accept the schematic design for the addition and renovation of the Tilton Library, 75 North Main Street? Mr. Decker.
Could we add the word draft schematic design in front of the schematic design? Because it's a draft. A lot of people want to see what's actually going to happen. And it's a draft that's out there in the other vote. It's not a final setup. And people don't want to know.
It says that. It says it doesn't come
before they really approve a design.
Town Council?
I think what the word schematic design is just that. It's a schematic design. It's not a final design. So the schematic design is, in fact, a draft design until you have a final design. So
would you prefer we put another sentence on it?
No, I don't prefer to do anything. Schematic means draft. It's whatever you prefer to do, but the motion is correct. It's not final.
Further review by the town meeting.
Oh, it has to
be.
Read the description. Right. Make a
motion. Then the town meeting has to approve the final design. Yes.
Are you making that as a motion?
That the town meeting will have to approve the final design.
Now before the town is a motion. Mr. Decker, if we can put that in writing at some point. The motion now is that the final design would need approval at town meeting. Is everybody clear on the amendment? Or I see some puzzled faces. So Mr. Decker has proposed an amendment where the schematic design would not be allowed to be the final design, that any final design in the library would have to come back before the town meeting.
Our town council just say that schematic means draft, and therefore, I think what you're asking for is already there, Mr. Beck. Yeah.
Any comment on Mr. Decker's amendment?
What is the amendment exactly?
Mr. Decker has requested that instead of the schematic design language that's in here, that there be an additional sentence that states that any final design of the library would require town meeting approval.
That's part of it. Trustees, do you want that?
Select Board wish to comment? On the amendment. I'm going to read the motion as amended. I move that the town accept the schematic design for the addition and renovation of the Tilton Library, 75 North Main Street. The final design shall be approved at town meeting. That's the motion that has been seconded.
Point of order, I guess. Isn't there a whole process for how, are we changing what the process is? And maybe we should get clarification from
Mr. Moderator, could you call on the OPM?
Mr. Pallotta, yes, please.
Sorry. Daniel Pallotta, project manager.
Louder.
Daniel Pallotta, project manager, 22 Tilden Lane. I'm used to saying that at my own town meeting. The language that's before you comes from the MBLC. Of course, you have the right to amend it. This is your town meeting. The purpose of schematic as defined by, as eloquently said by town council, you do get a third bite of this apple, and that's during the appropriation. And if you don't like the design, when it comes time to do the appropriation, you just simply vote no. So this gives you the ability to submit your grant, get your place in line, and then you can submit as a town any process you want before that appropriation as to review.
Thank you.
Is the
motion to amend? Yeah.
To follow up to that question, if the town does not approve the final design, and the town has accepted the grant, who will pay for all the costs?
You don't accept the grant.
Yes.
There will be no cost incurred. This town has spent zero tax dollars on where we are to date. $50,000 was spent from the MBLC planning grant that you applied for with similar votes a couple of years ago, and the trustees raised the matching portion of $25,000. So there will be no expenditure from the town. The grant simply is voted down, and the next town on the list gets the opportunity to take that money. You will not be spending any money until that vote.
Any other comment on the motion as amended?
I just have one comment. As you consider possibly changing language on a warrant article that's recommended by the grant obtaining authority, that language is very specific. When we voted on the roof project a few months ago, or back in January, whichever meeting it was, the language in that article is very specific. When we changed it and subjected it or made it subject to another vote, we had our contractors and all the people working on the project threatened to stop working on the project until the second vote was taken, because we no longer conformed to the right language for the grants we were applying for. So if you're going to amend this original motion, think very carefully about that. I don't know what the repercussions are. I don't know if council could speak to it. She certainly couldn't speak to it at the school building. We managed to get this project back on track by saying, you know, we essentially had the funds committed and we'd be able to fund the project, but literally the project designers, the OPM, everybody involved with it said, we're stopping work for 90 days, you're no longer going to be able to complete it in the time frames we originally set aside. So that's just a comment. Think about it as you consider possibly amending.
Any other comment on the motion to amend? Mr. Decker.
Yes, we take a 15-minute recess.
No.
Second.
No.
Is he amending?
We can at least look at the schematic if you give us some time.
Mr. Kadir. Right now, the motion before the board as amended, is there any other comment on the motion as amended? Yes.
Sandy Gokey, 64 Hillside Road. I'd like to argue against Mr. Decker's motion, even though I support the idea. I think it's an unnecessary motion. It's causing emotion. I think it's an unnecessary motion. I think the point of his motion is already incorporated by what the council is saying, and I think it's a tricky path to walk, so I'm arguing to vote against. The motion.
Any other comments on the motion to amend? All those in favor of the motion to amend?
Can you repeat it?
The motion as amended. I move that the town accept the schematic design for the addition and renovation of the Tilden Library, 75 North Main Street. The final design shall be approved at town meeting. That is a motion. It's before us. All those in favor of the motion.
Point of order. Don't we vote on the amendment first?
That's what we're voting on, ma'am. All those in favor? All those in favor? All those opposed? Motion to amend is defeated.
Back to the underlying motion by Ms. Maynard. One moment. I move that the town accept the schematic design for the addition and renovation of the Tilton Library, 75 North Main Street. It's currently the motion before. Mr. Decker.
Can we have a 5-minute recess to look at the schematic?
Give me one moment. Yes. So council has advised us that that motion is before the town at this point. So there has been a motion. It has been seconded. The motion currently before is to take a 5-minute recess.
Let's vote on it.
Is there any comment on the motion to take a recess? All those in favor of taking a recess? All those opposed to taking a recess? The motion does not carry. Article 7. I move that the town accept the schematic design for the addition and renovation of the Tilton Library, 75 North Main Street. Any further? There's been a call to questions. There's 7 minutes by the proponent. On the question. Point of order?
Yes, I'd like the designer to state that the schematic design phase is complete. I'd like to say I'd like the designer to make a statement to the effect that the schematic design phase is complete, which we are voting on.
We'll treat that as a question. Sir, if you'd like to address that question specifically.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. My name is Philip O'Brien with Johnson Roberts. I represent the designer. The schematic design is just the way it sounds. We have a scheme. The scheme at this point represents and acknowledges and addresses all of the issues that are described in the building program. And what we're looking for is permission to submit that design to the Board of Library Commissioners and the grant readers so that they can study it and give back feedback. Typically what will happen is that grant readers will review the design, and then there will be a series of things that they'll come back with. And schematic design actually will pick up again at the end of that, and we will complete the schematic design after the feedback comes from the Board of Library Commissioners. Any other feedback that we can get from the community in the meantime is welcome as well.
Thank you, sir. Okay, so only a proponent. Call the question?
Yes, call the question.
So at this point, the maker of the motion has 7 minutes to speak on the motion if she chooses, or she may designate anyone else in favor of the motion to speak, or you can waive it.
I waive it.
Nope. So the motion is before the town. Does anyone want the motion reread? All those in favor of the motion as presented? All those opposed? The motion carries. Concluding motion, I would make a motion to dissolve the special meeting. Second?
Second.
Motion carried. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
The meeting is dissolved. Thank you.